This is, in fact, one of the greatest maps in human history. You've probably all seen it, or maybe not. Why is it such a great map? First of all, it shows China as of 1080. The map itself was carved onto stone in 1136. The stone still exists that was carved onto. It's the earliest grid map in human history. The grid is 100 Chinese li, which is around a third of a mile to the square. It is focused on the river system. It is recognizably China. Some of the shapes are off, but it's also a clear sign of surveying, right? No, the great thing about a map is it represents something no one can see. It's sort of like a chronology in history, right? A chronology represents time over an extent that no single person can experience. A map represents the world, the landscape, beyond what any person can experience. And so if you think about it, right, to create a map is to create something and persuade people that that's what China looks like. You have no reason to think that China looks like that except for maps, right? And what happened the first time that people created a map and said, oh, by the way, emperor, by the way, grand counselor, this is what the country you're ruling looks like. Why would they believe that? How do you persuade them of that? What are the techniques you use to justify this? And in fact, the river system here is pretty damn good, right? The coastline is recognizable. There are problems with it all over the place, but it's not a bad map for the 11th century. It is the greatest map of its time for in human history, the earliest great map. There are other things we can do as well when we look at the past. One of the problems in historical GIS, however, is that that previous map we just looked at is not something we can rely upon to create a GIS for the simple reason that it's not exact enough, right? You can't use that as a base map. It's not what we would call mathematical cartography. So in creating an historical GIS, this can tell you something about where things are in relationship to each other, but it doesn't give you specific information for x, y coordinates from longitude, latitude. You have to have other methods of doing that. And one of the methods we have, actually, is remote sensing. Now, you might think that remote sensing, which goes back to the 1960s, really, is not going to be much use when we're talking about, let's say, 300 AD. But in fact, it is. And the reason why it is because with remote sensing, we can see very, very subtle differences in the landscape. So if you look over here, right, what we're looking at is the North China Plain. All of this area that we see shaded in red and from red to green basically is fill that's come out of the Yellow River over the last, let's say, 5,000 years. And so what we want to see here, but this is all now filled in, this is the here out to blue, in fact, is from red to blue, to white, is the current coastline of China. So all that is fill. And the Yellow River over time has moved and changed. If you look here, you start to see very subtle lines where that goes. And so what we want to do with remote sensing is begin to combine historical texts with remote sensing interests to figure out historical rivers, to figure out the movement, for example, of the Yellow River. And we're aided in that because when you do cross transections, we know that the Yellow River was diked. And dikes have one thing about dikes, they always break eventually. They never last permanently. So when they break, they always break to one side, unless you blow them up, right? And so there's always a difference in the land. Maybe only a meter, but that's enough to see with remote sensing. So we actually can, with historical records and remote sensing, we can trace the history of maps. The result is that as we work and as we create boundaries, problematic as they may be, we are creating a GIS that goes beyond anything that has existed before in terms of an historical atlas. We have an 8-volume. In fact, let me say very briefly about this. In the 1960s, beginning in the 1960s, work was done to create an authoritative historical atlas for China in 8 volumes. The people who did this were a group of historical geographers, mainly at Fudan University in Shanghai. We persuaded them to become involved with us in doing the research work to create this historical GIS. We've already found that the GIS we're creating is more authoritative than anything that they created in the past. In other words, the GIS is now becoming the authority for Chinese historical geography, not the printed version. You could print an atlas off of what we're doing, but you couldn't act, if you want authority, you have to turn to the GIS, which really is an important development. This is, I think, it's the first time in history that we've seen, or at least in academic history, that we've seen a historical GIS truly replace printed atlases as the authority for historical geography. And you can see the difference. The historical atlas, printed historical atlas, has boundaries like this. The current GIS time series has boundaries like this, far more exact and complex.